So tonight we're going to talk about bipolar disorder, sort of previously known for years and years as manic depressive illness or disorder. In 1980, I think the addition of the DSM that came out then changed it. We went from manic depressive to bipolar. So really the two are the same. So when we talk about this, we'll be talking about a major or significant mood disorder that is characterized primarily by episodes of depression alternating with periods of being periods of abnormally high or elevated moods. So as I go through this talk, what distinguishes this disorder from people that have recurring episodes of depression or people have an episode of depression is that there are these other episodes of mood where people have an abnormally elevated mood. So we'll be talking mostly about the elevated mood stuff. And I'll talk a little bit about depression in the beginning. It'll come up here and there, but mostly the focus will be on the elevated mood because it's the depressive mood is pretty much essentially the same as the people with recurrent depression. So we're going to the first slide. I'm going to talk a little bit. I'm going to go through some slides that will initially perhaps be a little boring because I just need to show you how we make the diagnosis or what are the criteria required to make a diagnosis of depression, hypomania, mania, and they get a little boring. So we'll talk about definitions of illness, then we're going to talk a little bit about just sort of general psychiatric management of illness, and we'll talk more specifically about more specific aspects of treatment. So to start with, let me just tell you a little bit about depression. I have one slide just to remind everybody what depression is, because this is a huge part of the bipolar disorder spectrum. It's not, as I said, the thing that distinguishes it from the other mood disorders, but it's a huge part of the bipolar patient's problems. So in order for us to make a depression diagnosis, people have to meet the criteria that you can see on the slide. So you must have at least five of these points on the slide, and out of the five that you have, you must include either the first or the second point, and then out of that you must have enough of these others to make up nine. So a typical depressed person with a depressive disease is somebody that has a pervasively sad mood and seems to have lost the ability to enjoy themselves. And in addition to that, they have these other things to various degrees where they usually have changes in weight and changes in sleep. So sometimes they sleep too much, sometimes too little, gain weight, lose weight. They're agitated or perhaps feel slowed down and very tired, have a lot of fatigue, worthlessness and guilt, concentration problems, memory problems, sort of ambivalent and indecisive and recurrent thoughts of morbidity or death. So this is how we make a diagnosis of depression. And so we'll talk about the treatment of that in this particular illness as we go along. So now I have to run through a few slides to talk a little bit about the other end of the spectrum. We're talking about the higher moods or the elevated moods. So really, things have changed a little bit as we've moved into the latest edition of the DSM. So if you notice that some of the things that I'm talking about tonight either are new or you thought I've missed something, I think I'll explain that before the talk is over, because things have changed in the last couple of months about how we make these diagnoses and how we define these illnesses, because we now have come up with our fifth edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Disorder that is used by psychiatrists around the world, primarily in North America. So the manic episode hasn't changed. This is kind of the severe elevated mood state that bipolar 1 patients get into, and I'll explain what bipolar 1 means a bit later. And in order to make this diagnosis, we get this distinct period of abnormally elevated, expansive, or irritable mood lasting at least a week. It's important to see the time thing there. If you are euphoric for a couple hours or for a day, it doesn't cut it. The time thing is very important. So it's an abnormal, elevated, expansive mood, and you must have three or more of these in order to make the diagnosis. So typically people sleep less, they talk more quickly, they have pressured speech, their thinking becomes a bit tangential, they jump from topic to topic, their thoughts are racing, they're highly distractible, a whole bunch of psychomotor energy moving around a lot, and excessive involvement in pleasure activities. So You know, I think underneath all of this, what you see is people feel expansively wonderful. They feel grandiose. And when they feel that way, they feel very well and they feel very special, I think, and they just don't think that no matter what they did, anything could go wrong. So you get people who feel so well that they don't worry about the consequences of what they might do because they just feel so wonderful, they don't worry about that stuff. And then you end up with people feeling, sorry, I should have used your clicker. You end up with people feeling extremely grandiose and feeling wonderful, and they end up being involved in a whole bunch of stuff that they probably normally wouldn't be involved in. So a typical, kind of a classical description of a manic person would be somebody who's comes to your hospital or comes to your office, and you know, and you learn that they haven't slept probably for 3 or 4 days, and before that they were sleeping very little for 4 or 5 days, and they have an elevated mood, and they're kind of infectiously happy, and they're euphoric. Often they're, if they're truly manic, and they may be delusional and believe that God has asked them to come and save the world, or they have some religious purpose, they're delusional about having spoken with God and about believing that they're going to go change the world or do something of that nature. And when you're talking to them, you can see that they're talking very quickly and very happy and very speedy and very pressured. So that's kind of a classic manic presentation. When you meet somebody who's totally manic, you know that you're dealing with somebody who's in trouble. I mean, this is not something that you can miss. When people are truly full-blown manic, it's you can't miss it. It's very noticeable. So in addition to the criteria I showed you on the last slide, people also must have their mood disturbance must be severe enough to impair their ability to work or function in a social sense, or they must be ill enough that hospitalization is required in order to prevent danger to themselves or others, or they must be psychotic. So as I said, most commonly full-blown manic people usually are delusional, and often it's around religious themes and things that they're going to do to save the world. They have a sense of, you know, very, very elevated importance that has become delusional. So that's the manic thing. So the other thing that we see in this abnormal, in this mood disorder, bipolar illness, is that people, there's another episode called a hypomanic episode, which is really just a mild or less severe episode of the mania. So in a hypomanic episode, you can see that this is the same. They have the abnormal elevated, expansive, or irritable mood only going on for 4 days instead of 7. They still need to have 3 or more of these criteria, and most people have most of them. But here, their mood disturbance is not sufficiently severe to impair their ability to work or to function socially, nor is it severe enough to require hospital, nor is it severe enough that they have psychotic features. So really the big difference between the two, they both have a mixture of all these things, but the manic episode lasts for at least a week. The hypomanic episode lasts for at least 4 days. And one of them will impair your ability to work, the other one would allow you to work. One requires hospital sometimes, the first one is psychotic sometimes, and the other ones are not. So those are the big differences. And really, when you know, you can if you have a hypomanic patient and they're able to continue working, usually the disturbance that you see when they come to your office is not anywhere near as evident or as serious or as obvious as the manic patient. So we have a couple of types of bipolar disorder. In our last edition of our psychiatric textbook, we had a bunch of types. Now we just have a couple. Bipolar 1 illness are those people that do have episodes of mania over the course of their illness. So this is a lifelong illness. It goes on forever. If you have an episode of mania at some time in the course of your life, if you're bipolar, then you're a bipolar 1 patient. So if you're 25 years old and you have a manic episode, and after that you never have another one, but you may have some depressive episodes, you might have some mild hypomanic episodes, your diagnosis is bipolar 1 disorder because you had one episode of mania. So sometimes it gets a bit confusing because you can see people that at age 60 years old, for the very first time in their life, they might become manic, and they've had 40 years of having mild hypomanic episodes alternating with depressive swings, and they've been labeled something else. And then if they're manic for the first time when they're 60 or 70, then the diagnosis changes to bipolar 1. So really the only important thing to remember about this bipolar 1 is you must have been manic at some time in your life. And the other episodes you have can be pretty much anything and everything from the spectrum of mood disorder that we talked about. So if you have a bipolar 2 illness, then you're not manic, basically, and you never have been. So you might have hypomanic episodes, and you would have had probably depressive episodes, but you don't have the manic episodes. So there's another disorder in here called cyclothymic disorder that existed in the last edition of the DSM as well as in this one. And this simply means that people have numerous periods of depressive symptoms and numerous periods of hypomanic symptoms for at least 2 years. And during that 2 year period, they can't have a symptom-free interval that's greater than 2 months. And during the 2 years, the symptoms have to be there for at least half the time. So that means that these people never meet the diagnostic criteria for hypomania or mania, so they're never euphoric for even 4 days. They might be euphoric for a day and depressed for a few days, but they don't ever get ill enough long enough for anybody to make a diagnosis of depression or mania or hypomania. So I have a fellow in hospital now. These people are not diagnosed very often. They're kind of fun to diagnose because they respond to treatment well, as most of the other patients do, and it's the kind of thing that's missed often, so it makes people feel good, I think, when you find them. But I had a guy in hospital a couple months ago, and he was a 75-year-old guy who'd been in BC for most of his life, and at one time he was in BC, and they really couldn't figure out what the heck was the matter with him, and they knew he had a mood disorder, and eventually they thought maybe he was bipolar, but they weren't sure, and they gave him some ECT, and he got better, I think. And then he went out, and he managed fairly well, living out by Rimby somewhere, but his moods, you know, were up and down, to various degrees over the course of his life. And then he got sick and went into the hospital out in Rimby, and they transferred him to Red Deer. And when he came into the Red Deer Hospital, you know, he had an ostomy, and when he came in, some mornings I would go see this guy, and he would be just the crabbiest guy that you'd ever want to meet. And he'd be bitching about his ostomy, and everything was going wrong, and he hated his nurse, and he didn't really want to talk to me, which is not really uncommon on a psychiatry ward, all of that stuff. But then I would go to the back the next day, and he'd almost be sitting on the edge of his bed singing and telling me how wonderful everything was. You know, and the switch in his mood was really, you know, so noticeable and so startling, I think, that it was pretty easy. We watched him for quite a few weeks before we started treating him, and he clearly was a pretty classical cyclothymic guy, which pretty unusual to see somebody who literally switches from being euphoric and hypomanic basically for one day and then really depressed and cranky and hopeless the next day. But he did that, and we treated him, and he did well with treatment. So that's that disorder. So then in the DSM-5, oh, that's nice. In the DSM-5, we have a new disorder. That's, you know, it's referenced in the DSM-4, but it's not a disorder of its own. We have a couple of these. So this thing, the substance or medication-induced bipolar disorder, is now a disorder of its own in the latest edition of the DSM. So we define that by saying that we have an elevated mood, you know, with or without a bit of depressed mood. So a lot of these people that come in with an elevated mood, and they may have a consistently elevated mood for a couple of days, just like that, or they might have a very elevated mood for half a day and then being kind of depressive and very upset for half an hour and back to an elevated mood. So you get some mixture of wild kind of mood disturbance or just steady, consistently elevated mood, usually for a short period of time, depending on what substance or what medication has caused this appearance of abnormal elevated mood. So in order to make this diagnosis, you must have the same mood that we've been talking about, and you must be able to find from your examination, your physical exam, or your history, or from the lab, you must be able to support the notion that this mood disorder developed either during or soon after intoxication with a substance or withdrawal from the substance or exposure to a med. And you must also be able to say that this particular medication or drug that you're talking about is capable of producing the symptoms. So having said that, it's, you know, when we see somebody come into the hospital and they look like they're manic or hypomanic, and we have no idea, of course, how long that's going to last for, and they tell us, and we do a urine screen, and it shows there's methamphetamines or cocaine or crack or something in their urine, we'd be highly suspicious that this is a substance-induced mood disorder. If we keep them in the hospital for a couple of days and they go back to normal, then we're pretty sure that that was a substance-induced mood disorder. But if the illness persists longer than the physiological effects of the drug that they're using, then you begin to wonder if it isn't something else. So that's really what all this stuff is saying, that in addition to the mood disorder, you have to be sure that it isn't better explained by some other diagnosis, which means that if, for example, somebody came in and then you're using cocaine and they were high, and then you discovered by talking to their parents that, you know, they were high 4 days before they ever used the cocaine, and you're sure of that, then of course this thing wasn't caused by the cocaine. So, you know, that would give you a question to doubt the diagnosis. And if the symptoms persist for a long period of time after the administration of the drug or the medication or the intoxication or the withdrawal, then you would think that that's a bipolar disorder, would be a substance-induced mood disorder. So we see lots of this in the hospital these days. There are lots of stimulants out there on the street. And people come in. The most common things we see are probably crack and cocaine and phencyclidine and crystal meth. And within the hospital, we see this happening with steroids. And you see it also happening with some of the antidepressants or with treatment for depression, such as ECT. So, and the one thing that you know, we always have to be kind of aware of in the hospital is that if you give somebody a medication or a treatment, like an antidepressant or electroconvulsive therapy, and they become manic, and this sort of carries on longer than the effect of the treatment, then you would assume that this person is bipolar. So what they're trying to say in the slide is, if somebody comes into your hospital or into your office and they seem to be having an abnormally elevated mood and they're on a bunch of Prozac and you stop the Prozac and in 3 days they're back to a normal mood, then you kind of have a medication-induced hypomania. But if you stop the medication and in a month they're still manic, then according to this textbook, then you're dealing with a bipolar illness. And that's been kind of a controversial thing forever, you know, whether if you give somebody an antidepressant and they show up in your hospital being manic, it's been a controversy forever. Can that just be caused by the drug, or is this person really bipolar? And so this is now the thinking, that these drugs can cause abnormal mood states that are short-lived and should go back to normal as soon as the medication is gone from your system, or as soon as the effect of the ECT is judged to be no longer present. If your mood state remains abnormal after the precipitating factor of ECT or medication is gone, then you're probably bipolar, and they're suggesting that should be about a month. So we see quite a bit of that also. So the other part is also true, that if you have somebody come to your office and they're bipolar and you're going to give them an antidepressant, then because of this, you have to be pretty careful about that. Because a small percentage of people that are bipolar, if you put them on antidepressants, will get manic, and that can be a very concerning and disturbing situation. On the flip side of it all, there's a fair number of people with bipolar illness, when they get depressed, you don't end up having a whole lot of choice but to use antidepressants sometimes. So then when you're doing that, you have to be pretty careful and take other precautions to make sure that they don't get manic. So I hope all that made some sort of sense. So this is the last little disorder in our new DSM-5, which is the bipolar disorder being caused by a medical disease. And again, you just get this abnormally elevated mood, and with all the energy and the expansive mood, and then you must have evidence that the disturbance is a direct pathophysiological consequence of another medical condition. So examples, the most common examples are these: stroke, multiple sclerosis, Cushing's disease. Pretty common. Sometimes difficult. I have a girl that I see in my office who's probably 35, who I've treated her for recurring depression for 10 years maybe, and she developed MS not too long ago, and then probably 2 or 3 weeks before her MS was diagnosed, she went floridly manic. So my first thought was that she was bipolar because her mother was bipolar, but then later she was diagnosed with the MS, so it became difficult to know for sure what she was on or what's going on there. But MS is something that's fairly, in the world of psychiatry, looking at the types of diseases that can cause an elevated abnormal mood state, that MS is probably the one that I see most often. The other thing that we do see is people with Cushing's disease, where you get abnormal levels of cortisol for different reasons. So if somebody is using cortisol as a drug or cortisone as a drug, or has a disease that causes your body to produce way too much cortisol, then your chances of getting manic are much greater than somebody that doesn't have those illnesses. So those are the things we most commonly see. People with traumatic brain injuries have various forms of elevated mood disturbances that look manic. So now in our DSM-5, I've listed the four disorders that we have, so then we have some specifiers for some sort of unique characteristics that might apply to your patient when you see them. So some people, when they come in, appear to present in a manic state with incredible anxious distress. And these are not people that are a little bit anxious. These are people that really look like they're about to jump out of their skin or horribly anxious. And if you see somebody like that who's bipolar, you would sort of code them as having a bipolar disorder with this anxious distress. When you see people that are bipolar and are having an episode that looks like they're hypomanic for one day and then they're, you know, depressed for half an hour and hypomanic for 2 hours and depressed for 20 minutes and all over the place, then you're seeing a patient that has a mixed picture. So you'd sort of use this specifier or code. People that are rapid cycling have four episodes in a year. So they might have three depressions and one hypomania or four hypomanias, just four episodes in a year, and then you become coded as being rapid cycling. If you have melancholic features, melancholia is a type of depression. It's a very serious form of depression. So when people are melancholic, the typical thing is that they have a lot of trouble sleeping. So often they'll wake at 4 o'clock in the morning and they can't go back to sleep and they're very agitated. They don't eat and they lose a lot of weight and they pace around and they can't concentrate. And these also are people, when you're with them, you know that these people are really ill, like they're very uncomfortable. They don't have any reactivity to their mood. Nothing you can say can get them to smile even a little bit. These are really seriously depressed people with markedly reduced sleep and markedly reduced appetite and usually a whole bunch of weight loss, and their cognition is not very good. On the other hand, we see depressive illnesses that we describe as having atypical features. So these are the people that eat too much and sleep too much. And if you show them a really good movie, they'll probably laugh and smile with you a little bit for a while. So their crappy mood isn't as difficult to distract them from. So these people are thought of as having not as serious a depressive presentation. These ones are seen as being very concerning. So the remaining specifiers are people that present and have psychotic features. A bipolar patient can have psychotic features when they're manic or when they're hypomanic or when they're depressed. So a psychotic depression is certainly more common in a bipolar patient than it is in a patient with recurring depressive illness. And as I said, if you were manic and you come to the hospital and you believe that the cameras are spying on you or that God has asked you to do something or that you in fact are Elvis Presley, or something of that nature, and you're delusional, then you're coded as having a psychotic disorder. Patients with catatonia, people often think of catatonia as being a schizophrenic condition because we used to divide schizophrenia into paranoid and hepiphrenic and catatonic. We don't do that anymore, but catatonia is still in people's minds often associated with schizophrenia. It's actually more common in bipolar. And that catatonia is a condition in which people have they tend to become immobilized. So in the classical catatonic description, a patient would stand motionless for hours or alternatively be very excited. So in the classical textbook descriptions, they would describe somebody who laid motionless in their bed for half a day or something, didn't move a bit, and then all of a sudden jumped out of the bed and ran up and down the hall. So they're sort of moving from catatonic stupor to catatonic excitement. So you can see it's a kind of a motor thing where people are showing energy at the extremes. And it's not horribly uncommon. Last year we had, I personally had two people in hospital that were catatonic. Right now I have one who came in, and this guy I have in hospital now has been my patient for many years, and when I first knew him when he was 40, he came to our hospital catatonic, and I actually looked after his mother, who was bipolar, and she on a couple occasions was catatonic. So this guy was catatonic when he was 40. And then when I saw him in the hospital 3 years ago, I went to see him in the emergency, I think, and he was sitting in a chair, and I asked him to get up, and he wouldn't move, and he wouldn't turn his head and look at me, and if I lifted his hand up, he just left it up in the air until I came back and put it back down again. So he's really motionless and truly kind of catatonic. And now he's on our ward. he's getting a little better, I think, and he's, you know, he can still see some catatonic features with him some days where he's, you know, overly excited and running around, but it's getting hard now to distinguish that from catatonia versus manic energy. So we have the catatonic specifier, peripartum. So if you get this illness when you're pregnant or within 4 weeks of delivery, then we would specify that this is a postpartum onset. And seasonal patterns, those are usually people that have either their mania or their depression recurs at the same time of the year over and over. And it's surprisingly common. You know, it's, people will come in and you'll be seeing them and they'll say, you know what, this is my third year in the hospital, and then they'll make some comment about it. It's strange, isn't it, that I always come here in November? I mean, you know, it seems like we often miss this with bipolar people, but it's a well-known common thing with depressive illness and happens also in bipolar. So those are all the specifiers for bipolar disorders. So this little slide is pretty self-explanatory, just sort of on a graph shows you this is kind of what we think is euthymia, which is a fancy word for a normal balanced mood. And as people get a bit elevated for a short period of time, they become hypomanic and they sort of move up the spectrum until they're very ill with a full-blown mania, and going the other way, they can be mildly depressed or severely depressed. And I guess I was just going to show you that the bipolar 2 stops here, that they never get higher than hypomanic, and once you get up into this mania, you're bipolar 1. So this is an interesting study that was done 10 years, I think. Yeah, 10 years ago by a guy called Judd in the States, and you can see that he followed about 150 bipolar 1 patients and about 90 bipolar 2 patients. He followed both of these groups for about 13 years. And I think the interesting thing is if you look at this, in both these groups, the bipolar 1 and the bipolar 2, the percentage of time over the 13 years that their mood was normal is about 50%. So not very impressive. These are people that are being treated and being looked after by somebody. And you can see that in bipolar 2 people, that during the course of that 13 years under responsible treatment, these people were depressed 50% of the time. And bipolar 1 people depressed 32% of the time. So then these little colorful ones sort of indicate the mixed states and the manic hypomanic states. And you can see in the bipolar 2 people have a grand total of 3% of their time over the course of the 13 years when they're have an elevated mood. And you begin to sort of, you know, we'll talk a little more about this later, but with this illness, one thing that's really common is people start to feel a little bit euphoric, often they don't come to the doctor and say, please help me because I'm getting euphoric. And you can kind of see why. I mean, if you had a 13-year stretch and half the time you're normal mood and 50% of the time you were presumably quite seriously depressed, and then you began to feel a bit elevated, you might just say, well, maybe I'll go with that, rather than go to the... People don't usually come to the doctor and say, please help me, I'm too happy. So, you know, you can kind of... There's a problem there, because people think, well, I'll just do this for a couple of days, and then I'll phone my doctor, but after a couple of days, their judgment gets impaired, and then they don't phone the doctor, and then they're in big trouble. But it's a really difficult thing to get people to call you and say, I'm starting to not sleep very well, I'm starting to feel too happy, please fix me. Because it just doesn't, you know, it doesn't make any sense, especially for the really unfortunate patient who's maybe been horribly depressed for 4 years. If they've been really depressed for 4 years and start to feel half decent because your mood is going up, you know, it's unlikely you're going to go running to the emergency room. So I think one of the biggest challenges that we have is educating family doctors and all of us that deal with this kind of stuff into identifying the bipolar patient. So the issue there is, if you have a patient come into the emergency room or into your office and she's 20 years old or 25 years old and she's had a couple episodes of depression, how do you know that this is a bipolar girl or is this just a girl who's depressed? Because when you look at the history of, you know, an average bunch of bipolar patients, the first episode for most bipolar patients is depression. The second episode usually occurs 4 or 5 years later. And you might have 4 or 5 depressive episodes before you ever get hypomanic or manic. So when you see somebody who's 20 or 25 and they're depressed, they could be bipolar, even though they've never had a bipolar thing. So then if you take that depressed patient and believe that they're not bipolar and put them on an antidepressant, and get a phone call in a week saying that they've gone psychotic and gone to Vancouver and getting in all sorts of trouble, it's a pretty scary situation. So we try really hard to get family doctors and psychiatrists to always ask the questions. When you see a young boy or a young girl who's under the age of 30, who's really depressed, we always need to remember that maybe this is bipolar. Mostly or significantly, because if you treat them with an antidepressant, you could be getting somebody into a lot of trouble. And also, if you want them to get well, the treatment for bipolar disorder, as you'll see, is a little different than the treatment for depression. So if you're going to treat them properly, you need to know what they've got. You need to know if they're bipolar or whether they're just having an episode of depression or a second episode of depression. So what this slide is all about is things that sort of help us help differentiate the depressed patient who's not bipolar from the depressed patient who is bipolar. So if your patient comes in and says, I'm really depressed, and they've had a number of antidepressant misadventures. So these things are common in the bipolar people, but not in the depressed people. So you put somebody on an antidepressant and all of a sudden they get more energetic and a little bit giggly and don't sleep for a while. You know, that kind of thing would clue you into there's a really good chance that this is a bipolar person you're talking about. The more people they have as first degree relatives in their family increases the risk enormously. It's the most important risk factor that people can have. So if you see a 25-year-old fellow who's depressed and he tells you that he has three first-degree relatives with bipolar disorder, his risk of being bipolar versus being just depressed is somewhere between 10 and 20% greater than otherwise. So this is a very important thing. These are pretty important. We see them quite a bit. This hyperthermic personality, I don't personally put a lot of stock on that. It just sort of means those very energetic people that are always running around, they say that that type of personality, the super energized, always happy, very, very positive person is more likely to be bipolar than unipolar if they come into your office when they're depressed. When people have very short episodes of depression, that's more likely to be bipolar. So when you look at what are the characteristics of a depressive illness in a bipolar patient compared to a non-bipolar patient, often their episodes are short. So sometimes for me, I'll get a referral from a family doctor saying, please see my patient, she's terribly depressed. And then I'll see her in 6 weeks or something and she'll be all better. You know, and that's not common, but it is pretty common with bipolar patients. So when you see these short episodes, it helps you think about the bipolar illness. So when you see a patient, you see a young, if you're called to the to the obstetrical ward to see a young girl who's psychotic after delivering a baby, the chances that she is bipolar versus just having a kind of a psychotic depression isn't bipolar or is much greater. There's a huge risk. The percentage of bipolar people that have postpartum psychosis or postpartum depression is much greater than non-bipolar people having those things. So it's a big warning flag. I have a girl in the hospital now who delivered four to 6 months ago and came in manic last week. And, you know, I said to her, well, she wouldn't talk to me. She was so angry about what I was about to stick her in the hospital. And she had all sorts of delusional things and had no intention of coming in the hospital at all, so she didn't like me one bit. But when I talked to her husband and talked to her family, they said there's all sorts of people. I think her mother or father or somebody's bipolar and probably somebody else in her family with depressive disease. So makes you think that this girl is probably bipolar. I guess we'll see when she calms down and decides to be more cooperative with me, but I would think that she probably is, just because that stuff is much more common in the bipolar patient. When you see people who have a very serious depressive illness and can't get to school when they're in grade 11, that's, you know, the chances that are bipolar are much greater than the chances that they're a regular depressive illness. This one I think is important. I always try to ask people about that, because I think the typical patient you see will tell you that if you followed every person you saw with a very serious depression in high school who couldn't make it to school because they were so sick, a huge percentage of those people would turn out 5 years down the road to have bipolar illness. And if you could figure that out for them when they were in grade 11, you would change the course of what would happen over the next 10 years. So it's really nice to know that. And these other things are also reported as being more common. I think probably it's true. Migraines are more common in bipolar people, but they're just so common that it's kind of hard to make much use out of that, I guess. I think because bipolar people have a much higher risk of serious anxiety disorders, 40% of bipolar Bipolar people have a comorbid anxiety disorder at the same time. So when you see people that are highly anxious with their mood disorder, quite often it's bipolar. And then, you know, the likelihood of them drinking or smoking pot or doing something to calm them down is greater. So we see a lot of bipolar people that have a comorbid anxiety disorder that are also using substances. And then it's not a very simple thing to sort out sometimes. So what do we do? So just in a very general sense, treating bipolar 1 and bipolar 2, there's a few very tiny differences, but really very little. We treat them pretty much the same. Usually people come and ask for help when they're acutely ill. So whether they're seriously depressed or seriously manic, they don't very often show up in my office saying, well, I'm in between episodes. And our goals, if you come to my office or to our hospital and you're acutely ill with a depression or with a mania, you know, then our goal really is to help with full remission of that episode. So the goal, obviously, is to get the patient better. Once you've got the patient better, then they kind of move into this thing called a continuation phase, which means that, so you have this acute phase when you're really very sick, then you enter remission and you're doing pretty well, and for about 6 months there's a higher risk of relapse. So that's kind of, that period is called by some the continuation phase, and once you're done that 6 months, then you move into this maintenance phase where our goal is to keep people well. So it's a kind of a curious thing, I think, when people come into the hospital or mostly into the hospital, and they come in and they're very ill, and they go home and they're 80% better. A lot of them are really happy with that, and they think they're not complaining anymore. And when I say, how are you? They say, I'm good. You know, and they're so much better than they were that they forget to tell you that they're still not really sleeping very well, or that their thinking is still too quick, or that they're having trouble concentrating. So often it seems when people are going through this maintenance phase and things are pretty good, that's a time when you really need to remember to ask these people all those questions. Like, are you sleeping normally? Can you function at work normally? Can you concentrate okay? Are you doing all right sexually? And all those things. So in the maintenance phase, you know, we need to make sure that people aren't getting a lot of side effects and that their medications are good, and we're trying to get rid of all the little symptoms that go on between episodes so that we can really get the patients feeling as well as we can. So when you decide how you're going to treat somebody, for the most part it depends on how does the patient appear to you today. So if I'm in the hospital and somebody comes in and looks horribly ill and I think they're dangerous or far too sick to continue making good judgment outside of the hospital, then I admit them. If I think they're not so ill and they'll follow up in my office and they'll do okay, then of course I send them home. If they come into the hospital and they're psychotic as well as being manic, I would give them antipsychotics. If they come into the hospital and they're suicidal, we might put in place extra precautions to make sure they don't hurt themselves. So it's kind of how you see the patient that particular day is the biggest factor in how you choose to treat them and where you're going to treat them, because you need to make decisions about hospital versus community. And that depends also, I mean, if you're going home with mom and dad and three other siblings who are all going to keep a good eye on you, then that's a lot different than going off to work in the oil field where nobody's watching and there's drugs all over the place. So again, we're, you know, it's a very curious illness in the sense that for quite a while, probably for the first decade of this illness, it's really difficult to get people to see that they have this illness. It takes a lot of work to persuade somebody that you are bipolar, or to persuade somebody that you have rheumatoid arthritis and it's going to last for a long time, or that you have multiple sclerosis. It's not an easy thing to take some young person and try and get them to be accepting of that. This illness seems to be a little more difficult than a lot, because there's something about the hypomanic and manic episodes that people like, quite understandably. It's not really the manic stuff people like, because by the time you're manic and you're psychotic, it's devastating and you're going to get into trouble all sorts of the place. But the milder stuff, where people are just having a really good time, then people often don't want to give that up. And when people become 30, or I mean, certainly you see people that are 20 who you can persuade them to look after their illness and be responsible, but a lot of people, you know, will end up being sick a number of times before they'll say, okay, now I'm going to really listen to what you're saying, and now I'm going to buy into what you're telling me, and I'm going to follow do my treatment. And so it's difficult to get people on board sometimes. So people tend to minimize what's going on. They minimize the difficulties they've had, and they have trouble seeing all the problems it can cause. So I have a girl, actually she's not my girl, she's a young lady who's in the hospital, who's not my patient, but I saw her for a second opinion not too long ago. So she came into hospital perhaps a month ago in an obviously hypomanic or manic state. I didn't see her, so I'm not really sure if she was psychotic or not, but she was very clearly sped up, hadn't slept for 3 or 4 days, and before that slept very poorly for about a week. She was had some grandiose notions, she was doing some risky things, her judgment was impaired, and it was obvious to her family and everybody who knew her, as well as the staff at the hospital, this girl was manic. So she came in, the doctor treated her appropriately with medications. After a couple of weeks, she went back to normal, and now she's doing pretty well. And then I was asked to see her, so I saw her, and I tried to talk to her about, what are we going to do with you? And so she said, well, I think I'll just go home. I'm fine. I don't know why I'm here anyhow, basically. So I said, it says here in your chart that when you came in, you hadn't slept for 4 days, and you were sleeping really poorly before that for 5 or 6 days. And she said something like, well, I just got a new job. I was pretty excited. It's not unusual for me not to sleep. And I said, well, then you came in here, and you were talking too fast, and your thoughts were all over the place, and people couldn't follow you very easily. There was clearly something wrong. She said, oh, no, I'm just like that when I drink too much coffee. So, you know, we went through this thing, at the end of which she continued to insist that she was never ill. So now, she's now well. She doesn't believe for a second that she was ever sick. She wants to go home, and then, so I guess she'll go home. I think her doctor's going to let her go home. And will she get sick again? Guaranteed. And will she get very sick and end up in horrible trouble or perhaps dead? Possibly. So, you know, what do you do to help this girl before she gets into big trouble? I mean, legally in this province, we can compel this girl to have treatment, but are you going to take some girl who's seems to be of normal mood, who isn't acutely ill right now, and tell her we're going to get the law involved and we're going to force you to take treatment whether you like it or not? It's a huge step, and most people wouldn't do it, but it's an interesting question, I think, because you would question if we let this girl go home in the next week or two, which somebody, we probably will, and something terrible happens in 6 months, we'll be asking ourselves, why didn't we compel her to have treatment whether she liked it or not? So it's a tough question. Certainly, I mean, if we force her to have treatment, she's going to be absolutely furious, and it's not going to be easy. But so, just in general, there's no cure for this illness. It lasts lifelong. Our goal is to keep people well over the course of their life and to eliminate all episodes. Sometimes we pull it off. More often than not, we improve people. Most of the time, we improve people enormously. We reduce the frequency of their episodes enormously and reduce the seriousness of their episodes enormously. A lot of that depends on their willingness to work with us, you know, because we don't have one little perfect treatment, and we kind of need people to help us to help them stay well. So as we go through time managing people, you know, we're keeping an eye on how they're responding to treatment. We realize that for some reason with this illness, intelligent as these people may be, that their insight into their illness is often somewhat limited. And we know that sometimes pretty small, if you get to understand your patient and you've seen them 5 or 6 times when they've been ill, it's pretty common to be able to say, well, Betty, you remember that the last 5 times you got sick for 2 days, you hardly slept at all, and you felt like having sex with your husband 3 times a week instead of never, and your friends all said you were giggling too much. So that's probably what's going to happen the next time you get sick. So if you can get somebody to work with you and watch for those things and phone you and say, it's happening again, I think maybe I'm getting a bit elevated again, you know, then of course your chances of helping that person stay well are much greater. So your success rate in dealing with these people with this illness, you know, depends an awful lot on how much you can get them to work with you. Because it depends on getting them to be insightful about their illness, which I think in my mind depends on your relationship with your patient. So if you can take the time to get the patient to be involved in what they see as a very positive relationship and educate them and ask them to help you, look after them, I think things go a whole lot better. So I think you need to sit with your patient and tell them all the stuff I just said about educating them about early warning signs about their illness, asking them to monitor their mood, find some way to get them involved in looking after themselves so that when they go home, maybe they'll be keeping a mood journal or a mood diary, keeping track of their sleep, you know, being aware of what things can cause them problems and then coming back and reporting to you. And I think if you can get them to the point where they feel like they're involved and have some control over this illness, over which previously seemed that they had no control over, that your likelihood of getting them to work with you is much better. So I think the relationship that you can build with your patient has a lot to do with the success, because we need the patients to help us. And again, so education, I think a lot of the, you know, it's like any other illness. If you're going to go to some person and say you have a chronic illness and you want them to somehow be accepting of that, then you need to take the time to really teach them what that's all about. I don't think it's reasonable to say go home and look it up on the internet. You kind of need to sit down with them or have your staff sit down with them and spend a lot of time asking all their questions to make it seem like it's a known quantity and that there are answers for this illness. And if you don't do that, then they're not going to work with you, and then you're going to have lots of problems. So patients do definitely benefit from education and feedback. They benefit enormously from the quality of the relationship they have with one of the people who are treating them. Often they might have a better relationship with their nurse than they do with their doctor, or in the community, a better relationship with their psychologist than they do with their psychiatrist, but they need to have a good, really good relationship with somebody, I think. So, you know, we push for a lot of education in the hopes that we'll get the patients to work with us in a collaborative role. And certainly, I think it's a very important thing. So, enhancing treatment compliance, again, I've said this already. People sometimes are just flat out in denial, but I think more commonly we see people that, yeah, sort of are on board with this whole idea and sort of not. Some days they're keen on following up with treatment and looking after themselves, and some days they're not. So they're kind of ambivalent, and I think that really the key to eliminating the ambivalence or taking a good stab at reducing the ambivalence is to give them some insight, which means some education and some support and a reasonable relationship with the treating professional. And as I said before, people really are, you know, amazingly reluctant to give this up. They're usually quite happy to say to you, I don't ever want to be manic again, I don't ever want to be psychotic again. But most of them will admit to you that when they were just a little bit happy and they were running around having a good time for a week and causing no trouble and still going to work, who in their right mind would want to give that up? The problem is it can grow into something worse. So they tend to recall the very happy, euphoric stuff of being a little bit manic, and they minimize the devastating effects of being seriously manic or the terrible, demoralizing effects of a serious depression. So when we treat, we're sort of promoting awareness of stressors also. So this illness, I mean, over and over and over again, the research shows that if you have a manic episode or a depressive episode, that consistently there's some kind of a stressor that precedes these things. So we try to educate people about what things stress you out, because it's different for everybody. You know, we all have our own little individual stressors, and it's another thing that you have to work collaboratively with the patient to help them gain some insight into what things stress you out. So, you know, I have a girl now who has, you know, she went to school for years and then became quite specialized in what she did. And now she goes out into the oil field and camps way up north somewhere, where she works 16, 14-hour days, and the men all give her a bad time, and they, you know, all the crap that goes on in the oil field camps, and she hates that stuff. But she has this bipolar illness. She goes out to work and works 16 hours a day. She rarely gets enough sleep. She's under stress all the time because she's up there trying to teach what she's supposed to be doing, and everybody's making fun about her. They're all sort of making sexist comments and giving her a bad time, and I keep saying, get out of there, like, get out of there. But of course she says, well, my income will be cut in half, but you know. So stress is not a good thing. The other thing that we find with a lot of bipolar people is that if you have a social rhythm disruption, it causes a problem. So these are shift work people. It's not uncommon for probably 10% of the people I look after that are bipolar, I write them letters to their nurse manager and say, this girl can't work on a shift anymore because the shifts are throwing out her cycles and it increases the likelihood of her having episodes. And if you take people off the shift work, a certain percentage of them, their episodes will reduce in frequency quite significantly. The other part where it comes into play is when you make a diagnosis in an 18-year-old person, and say to them, you know, you need to be going to bed at a reasonable time, you need to be getting reasonable sleep, and you need to eliminate stress. So you need to, you know, when now you're in grade 11, you can't have any more fun. We want you to go to bed at 11 o'clock. We don't want you ever to drink beer. We don't want you to have any relationships, maybe, because they might be stressful. Definitely no marijuana. Who in the hell is ever going to listen to you, right? So it's hard, you know. And then, so then you have these kids that are staying out at night, and, you know, they're increasing their risk for getting sick. And most of them realize that, but most of them continue to need to be accepted by their peer group. And I think we sort of need to understand that they need to be accepted by their peer group, because you can't ask them to not have a life, whether you're talking about bipolar or any other disorder. So, you know, it's figuring out how to find some happy medium with all that stuff. And, you know, if you get too dictatorial with all this stuff and start insisting that, you know, if you don't do all these things, I'm not going to see you anymore, or if the parents start saying, because the parents are pretty upset. You know, if you have an 18-year-old girl who's messing up at school because she's been in the hospital for depression, then she's been in the hospital for hypomania, and she continues to go out at night and party with her friends and not get reasonable sleep, and the parents sort of understand that if she would just never party and never go to bed after 11 o'clock at night, parents know that she would do better. But, and then sometimes parents are angry, but you kind of need to, your kid has to have some sort of life, so you have to negotiate some compromises, which isn't always very easy. So this is really important. If you can get your patient to help you notice, that you need to get the patient to be able to notice early signs of relapse. So I think you work and you work and you work at that. People keep diaries. It's not, people realize if you just sit somebody down who's had half a dozen episodes of whatever, maybe even three episodes of whatever, and say to them, what do you like in the week before you get sick? Most of them can tell you that this is what happens. I get this symptom, and then I'm sick. And so then you say to them, well, the next time you get these three symptoms, please phone me. So it's pretty simple, and it helps a lot if you can get people on board with that. You can't always identify these things, but, you know, it's really worth a try, because more often than not, you can. These things are pretty common. Before people get sick, sleep pattern falling apart is very common. I think it'd be unusual for anybody to become hypomanic and come and see me and say, I'm sleeping fine. Very unusual, unless they're smoking tons of pot or drinking lots of beer. Then increased thoughts about religiosity, increased thoughts of sexuality and grandiosity. I find the sexual thing is, you know, very frequent, you know, and it's not, you know, you just have to ask people. People are embarrassed sometimes. You have, you know, 40-year-old married women and you're asking them, but you're just asking them, you know, before you get sick, do you notice that you think more about this stuff? I mean, you don't have to ask them, what are you doing in the bedroom, or you're more active sexually. It's just because really what they're noticing is that they're thinking more about it. And people remember that, you know, and usually most people get increased sexual thinking before they get hypomanic or manic. And if you ask them in a sensible way, they'll tell you. And if you ask them to let you know if it happens again, they're okay with that. And so those things are worthwhile, I think. So we've said this, in all acute episodes of elevated mood or depression, control of the symptoms is the main goal. We'll talk a little bit about treatment. So when you're manic, mood stabilizers and antipsychotics both are effective in the treatment of mania. Not surprisingly, if you use a bit of both, you'll probably get your patient better faster. If your patient is mildly ill, you can usually get away with one or the other. And if somebody comes into the hospital and they have an elevated hypomanic mood or a manic mood and they're high to some degree, you need to get them off their antidepressants. It's not saying that they always cause the problem, but you can't have them on a happy-making drug and then be giving them other drugs to slow them down. It's just sort of silly, really. So when you select your treatment, of course, you're going to decide a bit depending on how sick they are. Sometimes these people are very sick. I mean, sometimes these people literally haven't slept for a month and they're running all over the place and they haven't eaten and they haven't slept and, you know, they're doing dangerous things, and they're just going to drop one of these days if you don't slow them down. There are times when you just really need to get this person slowed down in a hurry, and other times where things aren't so bad and there isn't any big rush. We look at things like psychosis. If somebody's delusional, we'd add an antipsychotic. If your patient comes in and says, I've had this problem four times before and the quetiapine really worked for me, then why wouldn't you give them that? if you can look back in the old chart and see what worked for them, of course you would give them that also. So those things are important things to think about. There's a lot of evidence suggests if your patient shows up in a mixed state where they're kind of happy and depressed four times a day, so they're depressed, happy, all in the same day, there's some evidence to suggest that Epival or Depakote or valproic acid works better for mixed states. We use a lot of antipsychotics to slow people down and to help with their delusions if they have that. And the newer antipsychotics are called atypicals, so we use more of those than the typicals, which are just the older ones with more side effects. So there is, you know, lots of research looking at how well does therapy work, how well does stress management work, how well does CBT work. Doesn't work for mania or hypomania. Certainly it works for depression, works for all sorts of things, but it's not effective by itself for manic or mixed states. So if you have somebody in a successful course of medication, whatever that is, and they're, say they're on a bit of lithium and a bit of Seroquel or something, and 3 months after they left the hospital they seem to be slipping a little bit, you would just make sure that you've got your doses right. In the hospital, if somebody isn't coming along as fast as you would like, you have to remember these things take time. People make big mistakes by, you come into the hospital in 3 days you're not all better, so they double the dose, and in 5 days you're not all better, then they quadruple the doses. There's no sense in that because it takes 2 weeks for these things to work. If the first mood stabilizer by itself is not effective, the Canadian guidelines would suggest combining a second one. And then we have a lot of other drugs that we use. We've mentioned antipsychotics. Clozaril is kind of a unique antipsychotic that works particularly well, but has a lot of side effects. And sometimes we use, because we're trying to slow people down, help them sleep a little bit. So if we give them some Valium or some olanzapine for a week or two or whatever it takes, we do that. Then the trick becomes, once your patient is down at a pretty normal mood, you kind of have to get, when they come into the hospital and things are wildly out of control and you put them on a mood stabilizer and nothing really happens in the first day or two, then to add something to help them sleep and to get rid of their delusions is very sensible. And then if they're very anxious and pacing around all the time, to add something to help them slow down, I mean, those are all sensible things, but when it's time to go home or when they're getting better, you have to remember to get rid of those things. So these days, when we don't like to keep people in hospital very long, you know, it's a common thing to have somebody in a hospital. So I'll get a call saying, we have this girl in Centennial Center and she's coming out in 3 days. Will you see her in your office in a month? And then I say yes. So then she comes to my office and she's kind of off balance and staggering around, having all sorts of side effects because she's on tons of medication, which I guess she probably needed 6 weeks ago. But then she didn't need them all by the time she came to my office, right? So, you know, it's a bad time, I think, to leave somebody kind of unattended. When you leave the hospital, you need to be following up with them pretty carefully to make sure you're not leaving somebody out there on a ton of medications. So as far as depression goes, our aim is to get you back to normal psychosocial function, and our aim is to avoid making you sick by giving you a bunch of antidepressants that could make you sick. So with respect to depression, interestingly, most people would say, well, if you have a bipolar depression, I guess what we would do first is give you an antidepressant. But if you look at all the guidelines across the world, they would say the first thing you should do is give them a mood stabilizer. So somebody who's bipolar, who comes into your hospital and depressed, the recommended family of drugs that you go to first is mood stabilizers. But if you look around the world and see how often that is done, it's not as common as what you would think. So these drugs are some of the mood stabilizers. This drug, lamotrigine, is well known for having a good solid effect reliably on a bipolar depressed patient. It has good antidepressant activity. Lithium has pretty decent antidepressant activity. The other ones are not so good. The other drug that we use a lot of is valproic acid or Epival. It's being shown recently to have a little more antidepressant activity than we thought. So, you know, if you have a bipolar person coming into your hospital and they're depressed, then it makes sense if you're going to put them on a mood stabilizer. Of course, you pick one that will work to treat their depression, right? You wouldn't put them on carbamazepine or some other mood stabilizer that isn't effective for depression. So if the mood stabilizers don't work, or you think you need to add something to them to make them work better, then that's when we start using the antidepressants. So we're kind of careful with them because we worry that people are going to switch from being depressed into being manic or hypomanic. You know, there isn't really a lot of good information about what antidepressant is best for the bipolar depressed patient. They all seem to work, but they have a different risk of switching. So often the antidepressants are picked in a bipolar depressed patient based on what's the likelihood that this drug will make your patient manic. So there is an old group of drugs that most of you have never heard of called monoamine oxidase inhibitors that are incredibly powerful antidepressants, and their risk of causing bipolar depressed people to go manic is very high. So you would never use those things. Another really old group of drugs is tricyclics that are also quite powerful. Their risk is also pretty high. So it kind of goes on the spectrum. The MAOIs are the worst, the tricyclics are a little better but bad. SSRIs are pretty good. And the one that's missing in here, there should be one in here called the SNRI. So the Effexor, Cymbalta, Prestique drugs are a little bit more concerning than the SSRIs, the Prozac and Cipralex drugs. And the one that's the best, that very rarely causes switching, is Wellbutrin or Bupropion. So you can select your drug according to the risk, but if you put somebody on Bupropion and it doesn't work, then of course you're going to have to pick something else. We use ECT for these things. Part of the reason for that is there's nothing that will work faster in a manic or bipolar depressed patient than ECT. So I think for me, if I see somebody so horribly ill and I know they're bipolar and I just think this can't go on for very much longer, I would consider using ECT. ECT gets used in pregnant bipolar people because you don't want to, most of these moms don't want a bunch of drugs floating around in their uterus, and a lot of the mood stabilizers we use are concerning in pregnancy. And in complex medical patients, we often do ECT because we don't want to add more drugs to their already growing list of drugs. So we mentioned earlier that there is a specifier called rapid cycling. So if you're rapid cycling and you're having mixed happy and depressive things all in the same day, one of the things that we commonly see is that you might have a condition or using something that aggravates that. So if you have a patient that comes in and has been fairly stable and all of a sudden they're having frequent little mood flips all over the place and you're kind of wondering why is their stability kind of change into the mood flippy thing, then you look and make sure somebody hasn't added an antidepressant or that the thyroid isn't going out of whack or they aren't doing something with street drugs. Usually it's fairly easy to settle down. We use valproate, as I said, mostly for the mixed states. There's more and more evidence for lithium being useful for that. Some of the newer antipsychotics are pretty good at sorting that out, and we often end up using medication combinations while these people are acutely ill, and then, of course, you hope to streamline that and taper that all down when they get better. Lots of problems around pregnancy. One of the things that people sometimes forget is some of these drugs, like these two, Tegretol and Topamax, effectively render your birth control pill useless. So it's a kind of a good thing to know. If you're pregnant and need to be on a mood stabilizer, most of the anticonvulsants that are used as mood stabilizers, like valproic acid and carbamazepine and lithium, have risks. So, you know, it's a very individualized thing. If you have you have to sit down with your patient and discuss how your illness usually goes. If you and the patient agree that it's probably pretty unlikely you're going to get sick throughout your pregnancy, then probably you would give them nothing. If you see somebody who says, I don't care what you give me, I just don't want to get sick, and you know that they're now in their fourth month, then you don't worry so much about giving them things that might cause problems for the baby. The problem is that you can't, if you have a patient who's pregnant and they have a horrible depression in month six or a horrible manic episode in month six, probably in all fairness, they're doing potentially a lot more damage to their fetus than if you had them on some of the drugs that we use. We have some that are, of course, much more safe than others, and lots that are considered very safe. It's a tricky thing in the bipolar disorder because most of the mood stabilizers are problematic. So it's always something that, if you can, you want to plan it. So you want when you have patients that are bipolar, you need to sit down with them and say, in a few years when you decide to get pregnant, I want you to come and talk to me and tell me that you're going to try and get pregnant, then we'll make a plan. Unfortunately, mostly what we see is people coming into the emergency saying, well, I'm pregnant, I'm bipolar, and I've been on all my drugs, and now I'm 4 months pregnant because I didn't know I was pregnant. So then you go ahead and do whatever you do, and everything always seems to turn out fine. But if you look at the research over the years, there are problems in a very small number of babies. I have never seen it. I don't know anybody that's ever seen it, but it happens. So we certainly don't encourage people to just recklessly do that, but You know, when you have somebody who has a really difficult to treat bipolar disorder, there are certainly ways to keep them well during pregnancy, if you have to. So the way this illness usually goes, it tends to last lifelong, tends to come in cycles. Usually people are depressed when it begins, sometimes manic, but usually depressed. In the beginning, their episodes can be pretty erratic, so they might have 3 or 4 years before their second one, then only a few months before their third one, and it's pretty unpredictable. After you've had a few episodes and things sort of settle down, and if you start having a bit of a depression or something every third year, then more than likely, in most people, you can say, well, that seems to be your pattern. So you can't always do that, but there is a tendency to be able to do that. So often there's quite a few years between the first and second episodes, so you can kind of see again if you're depressed when you're 17 and depressed when you're 21 and depressed when you're 25. You could still be a 25-year-old person coming to my office complaining of depression and be bipolar, because you might well be bipolar and not had your first manic episode, right? That's when we have to ask all the questions. But I guess the big star says variability is what we see more often than not, and we have to remember that. You just can't pigeonhole the course of this illness usually. So we've said this, usually depression happens a few times before mania, but not always. Therefore, we've done all this talking about how do you distinguish the bipolar depressed patient from the non-bipolar depressed patient. You always need to, when you see a young depressed person, always need to ask about these things. Usually if you ask, people will tell you. More often than not, if you ask in a reasonable fashion, and how, you know, making the diagnosis will alter the treatment decisions, because if your patient is suffering a recurrent episode of depression, is not bipolar, then you're going to treat them with antidepressants, obviously. And if they're bipolar, and especially, and if they're bipolar and they're depressed, then you're going to, the recommendation is you'd go with a mood stabilizer first. When you have a bipolar patient, there's really no reason ever that this person shouldn't be on some sort of mood stabilizer, because you can't have, if you have somebody on an antidepressant all the time, then you're tending to want to drive them into a abnormally elevated state. If you have them on some kind of tranquilizer or antipsychotic all the time, you're tending to drop them down into being depressed. So you need to be, you always need to be on a mood stabilizer with very few exceptions. Fairly significant mortality. Bipolar 1 patients, 10 to 15% of successful suicide. Not surprisingly, usually when they're depressed. This illness causes a lot of morbidity. A lot of people, especially with bipolar 1 patients, will have continuing work problems even between episodes. So I think some of that is we need to work harder. When people have been free of a mood episode for 2 years, you need to work harder at eliminating their little symptoms, because sometimes the medications impair their functioning at work. Sometimes they're still a little bit depressed, or sometimes they're not sleeping very well, and that can interfere with their problems at work. So when people are between episodes and doing fairly well, that's when you really need to work really hard at eliminating all the little symptoms and looking very carefully for lots of medication side effects and taking care of that. That's it. And we sort of hinted at the business of, you know, because it runs in families, we know that, you know, in far the majority of people, probably 75% of people, this is a genetic illness. So, you know, so if it's genetic, there's something physiological, you know, you're inheriting some physiological disturbance through a genetic pathway. So there's something going on in your brain that you're getting abnormal production of mood-controlling chemicals. It's like a lot of these illnesses, we like to give people little diagrams and say, this is how it works. We don't really know how it works. We like to give people simple pictures so they can wrap their mind around how it works, but we have a lot to learn about how they work. So what we know is it's genetic. There are definitely biochemical abnormalities that you can measure in people that have this illness, especially when they're sick. And you learn a lot, too, by the types of medications that make them better, because if you get better by giving them an antipsychotic that increases your dopamine, then probably there was something wrong with your dopamine. So they have a pretty good understanding of this, and it's improving all the time, but we don't understand it totally. Oh, for sure, absolutely. Yeah. That's what we try to do, right? So, I think to say, Can you treat somebody so they don't ever have a cycle again? You can, but you know that really depends on cooperation, right? I have an interesting girl that I often tell people about who I met a long time ago, who when I met her, I knew this girl because I used to go to the hockey rink and watch her play. And she was a pretty timid little girl and was a decent enough player. And then I went and watched her a few times because my daughter was playing with her and she was becoming more aggressive. She was getting foul on the rink and she was much more energetic. And I kind of wondered what was going on. So later, anyhow, I met this girl. Her father phoned me and asked me if I would see her after she'd been to see a few other people. And they didn't make the diagnosis, I guess. So anyhow, I saw her, admitted her to the hospital, put her on some lithium, I think, and then now that was when she was 17, and then she developed every side effect in the world from this lithium. She had horrible acne all over the place. She was up peeing all night long. She had a tremor and couldn't write very carefully, and I said to her, let's take you off this drug. I mean, your response to the drug has been very well. We can probably find a better drug. She said, I'm never going off that drug, because she didn't ever want to get sick again. So now, 15 years later, she's out working in some huge city, has a master's degree, is married, has never been sick in all that time. And she has never gone to see another doctor because the different cities that she moves in, they all have year-long, two-year-long waiting lists to get in and see psychiatrists. So she sends me her lithium levels and she sends me little notes every once in a while. And so, you know, she was a classical bipolar. This girl was psychotic and really sick, and she has been fine. I think twice that I can remember in the last 10 years, she called me and said, I think I'm getting a little down, or I think I'm getting a little racy, and we just tweaked something, and she's been fine. So I have quite a few people like that. But, you know, it's not just good treatment. It also, it's a bit of luck. It's the nature of the illness that you have, right? Well, if you look at the clinical practice guidelines, that's what they say. With this particular girl, I said to her one time, you haven't been sick for 10 years. Do you want to try life without your drug? Because you and your husband, you watch so carefully. I know you'll phone me. I know you're diligent. She said, no. So, you know, I have a couple people where I've considered stopping their drugs, but it's a scary thing. You know, if stopping the drugs and you're, you know, 3 years later and you start to feel a bit happy, you're not really, and you're on some holiday in Hawaii and you're just feeling a bit bubbly, you might think, oh, what am I worried about? And the next thing you know, you're in some hospital. So I think most people would say, don't stop. Don't stop your mood stabilizer, but do your best to minimize your drugs. Yeah. You know, if you want to do it successfully, then you treat both at the same time, for sure. I mean, it used to be that if you were in Red Deer or anywhere else in Alberta, you'd go in and say, well, I'm bipolar and I have a drinking problem, and you'd go to ADAC and they'd say, oh, no, you have to go to mental health. Then you'd go to mental health and say, I'm bipolar and I'm alcoholic. They'd say, oh, no, you have to go back to ADAC. So now we've kind of figured that out. We have ADAC workers or addiction workers on our hospital wards. We have addiction workers that come into our conferences in the outpatient services, and we have treatment centers that are specifically built for the treatment of both. So, you know, the answer about how do you do it best is you treat both at the same time. But, you know, it's not always easy to make a diagnosis because there's a lot of people that show up in emergency and they, you know, I saw a girl in there a couple months ago who was maybe 35 years old, and they asked me to come and see this girl, and she was moving at 10,000 miles an hour around this little room, and she was talking so fast I couldn't understand what she was saying. She was giggling and laughing and just so manic. I was frightened for her safety. She was just so out of control. And we did a urine screen on her, showed all sorts of cocaine and methamphetamines. And so I'm thinking, well, I guess she's using those things, but this girl is going to be sick for quite a while. So I'm going to come back in the morning and make sure that she's, you know, we have her meds adjusted right. I came back in the morning, she was fine. So, and that's what they say. I mean, once the physiological effect of the drug is out of your system, if that's a drug-induced mania, then your mania should settle. You know, when people take a bunch of crack and then 2 months later they're still manic, then that's probably not just caused by the crack. I'm not sure if that's really what you were asking, but... don't like it, don't agree with it, yeah. Well, I mean, of course, if you talk to them, they say, oh, no, we have a psychiatrist coming once a month, and we have a psychiatric nurse here and there, but yeah, no. I don't know. I mean, it's political, I think. I mean, I don't know what you do except to complain and make lots of noise, honestly. So I do think that there's more and more psychiatrists that are specializing in forensic psychiatry, but you still have to get the system to invite them to come enough, frequently enough, to do a good job. Most of the guys that I know that like forensic psychiatry won't go to the prisons because the prisons only want them there occasionally or once a month, and they can't do a good job and once a month, so they don't go. I mean, I guess the easy answer would be to say no, because the guidelines say you should, you know, guidelines say that you should. Around the world, all the guidelines that are put together by all these super experts say that you should take, if you have this illness, you should take the recommended treatment. And the recommended treatment is to have some medication in your system every day. But, you know, for example, with lithium, I think, is a good example for me. So I have patients on lithium, and they have a tremor, and they have diarrhea. And so I give them lithium every second day. And then if they stay well for 6 months and they're still having some side effects, I have people on lithium once a week. So that's not, that's just me and what I believe in, and it works for me. And so I think if you're, as a clinician, if your patient is willing to take lithium once a week and yet she's not willing to take meds every day, then you need to be, try and be flexible around that, right? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of uncharted area. I don't know of any research that says, show me a research paper of any quality that proves that once a week will help this person, right? Mm-hmm. But in my own experience, I use lithium once a week sometimes. So if your patient wants to not take medications but be preventative when she sees the onset of a up or a down coming, would that be okay? That's what you're asking me, I think. I mean, like I said, it's not recommended in the guidelines, but of course that'd be much better than not taking anything, right? Because people know when they're getting depressed. I mean, depression is a fairly easy thing to spot, and people are pretty comfortable about going to their doctor when they're getting depressed. You know, most people are pretty poor about phoning their doctor really quickly when they start to get up, which is kind of that's the devastating part of the illness. If you're bipolar 1 and you get really manic and get into lots of trouble with that, that's what I worry about, because you see people, you know, get into horrible trouble with that illness, right? If you really get full-blown psychotic. So I guess, you know, what you're suggesting isn't probably the best way to do it, but it's better than not doing anything.
And depends on the one-on-one.
Yeah, it depends. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think hypothetically, you know, a person should be able to make that work. If your patient was bright and motivated and insightful and had a physician or a therapist or somebody who's willing to work with you, and you had a plan to be really observant and, I don't know, all that stuff, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I can't see it being impossible, but it's just not what's recommended. Mm-hmm. But it sort of makes sense, right? No, with the manic stuff, I mean, it varies also. Sometimes it can go on for, sometimes a couple of weeks. But, you know, if you're bipolar 1, sometimes people slide into full-blown manic states pretty quick. So sometimes you're talking about a few days. So I would say anywhere from, you know, 2 or 3 weeks to 2 or 3 days. It varies quite a lot. And, of course, for the people that have 2 or 3 weeks, then it's easier, you know. It's not impossible to do when you have a couple of days, but you really got to be on your toes for that. Well, they run a risk of being driven into a manic state. But, you know, if you took a whole bunch of, if you had 100 of those teenagers and you gave them all antidepressants, probably only 25% of them would get into trouble with it. But if you have a bipolar person and you treat them with an antidepressant, you might get away with treating that depression reasonably, but then you don't know what the diagnosis is, and then you're just waiting for something called mania to happen, which can be terrible, right? So, you know, basically what you're saying is, okay, so you've missed the diagnosis, you've done nothing to put them on the proper treatment to prevent the next episode, so you've missed the diagnosis, and even if you get them better, are they going to get, if they're bipolar, are they going to get sick again? You betcha. So you might fix her, and often, like most of the time, if you treat a 17-year-old girl who's bipolar and depressed with antidepressants, three quarters of the time it'll work. But the, you know, I had a girl, a nurse, 4 or 5 years ago, went to her family doctor, was very depressed, never been manic before, family history of bipolar, he didn't ask. Lots of doctors don't. I mean, everybody's busy, right? And they forget to ask the question sometimes. So he quite legitimately gave her some paroxetine or some antidepressant. And in 2 weeks, she was in Vancouver. She was sleeping with everybody in sight. She got into trouble with a bunch of drug dealers. She had criminal charges. She lost her nursing license. Her kid was apprehended. It was horrible. You know, so, you know, saying that you can't reasonably expect every doctor to always ask every depressed person, have you ever been hypomanic? Because it just isn't going to happen, you know. But, you know, the antidepressants sometimes can cause terrible problems. Usually people get away with it for a while, though. Well, I mean, clearly you're providing some support, and you offer when you can to offer some kind of common sense advice. But, you know, I don't think there's a whole lot more that you can do. I mean, yeah, you're getting educated yourself, you're providing support, you can reach out to other agencies for help, but how do you persuade this person? I mean, if he gets really sick, you know, then you can look at legal things if you want to, but they have to get pretty sick for that. And even to do that, I mean, to get a psychiatrist or a doctor and the police to go pick up somebody who's, legally they can pick somebody up who's at risk for deterioration. But when I phone them and I say, I have this patient in the community, I know that he has this illness, he could get really sick, and under the Mental Health Act, I know you can go pick him up because he's got this disease and he's at risk for deteriorating right now because he's not taking his medications, so legally you can go do that. They'll say, no, that's not true, that's not true. But then when you point out and they go read the act and come back, the staff sergeant will phone me and say, well, you were talking to my constable, and yeah, you're right, we could pick him up, but we see that as very low priority, so we'll put it on our list of things to do, and they kind of forget about it. It doesn't work very often. But there is, I mean, if you really wanted to do that, I mean, there is a team in Red Deer called the PAC team, which is composed of a police officer and a psychiatric nurse who are very knowledgeable about psychiatric things and RCMP things. So they're a good group to talk to if you thought there was ever a time that you might want to pull that and see if you could compel that person to be taken to the hospital.
And it's called the
PACT. PACT. You can phone the main office at the Mental Health 340-5466, just the main switchboard, and get their number. Yeah, I mean, I think it's, you know, I mean, in this illness, I mean, we consider the medication to be the mainstay of treatment, right? Because there is no proof that any of those other things will ever effectively treat this illness by itself. Obviously, if you have somebody who's got this illness and has a substance abuse problem, you need to energetically do your best to deal with both. If, you know, if you have a patient who's actively using all sorts of substance and has this illness, I think you have to treat them anyhow. You do your best at trying to treat them, but you can't treat somebody who's a raging alcoholic with lithium because they're going to forget that they already took it that day and then take three times the usual dose, and then they're going to be in trouble because their lithium levels are too high. But there are, you know, you have to do some safe approach in terms of medication. But I think if your patient is willing to go for psychotherapy, then that would begin with some kind of educational process and development of some kind of relationship so they can help get better at seeing when their symptoms are emerging. But having done all that stuff, when you're just talking pure medication management, you know, some people are pretty devastated by this illness. So then you're dealing with self-esteem issues, and I'm sad because I'm sick, and how do I adjust to a chronic illness? And that's all those things are good things that a therapist can do for you, right?